Hi everyone, welcome to Itasca Water's Practical Water Wisdom Series. I'm Brian Whittemore, your host for today. We have another great session for you on a subject we in Minnesota care passionately about, loons. Specifically, our presenter today will talk about loon restoration in Minnesota. We'll get to that in just a moment, but first let me tell you a little bit about Itasca Waters. We're a local volunteer nonprofit headquartered in Grand Rapids, Minnesota. Our goal is to continue to find interesting ways to educate residents and others who have an interest in keeping our waters clean. We've been teaming up with like-minded people and organizations for 16 years, and you can read about those projects on our website at itascawaters.org. If you have an interest, please consider joining us and becoming a member or a volunteer to help support programs like this. And we thank our partners shown on your screen for their support in producing this program. Today's program, as I said, will be about loons. Following the presentation, our speaker will answer questions from you. To submit a question, click on the Q&A button at the bottom of the screen and type in a brief question. You can do this at any time, and we will read the questions on your behalf. By the way, we will not be using the chat function today. This program is being recorded and will be available for viewing online through our website at itascawaters.org. One final thing, please click on the survey link, which will be on screen at the end of today's program, or you can complete the survey that will be sent to you by email, and we do appreciate all comments and suggestions. Jaden Jeck is a loon specialist with Minnesota DNR's Non-Game Wildlife Program. Jaden works to promote the conservation and the conversation and restoration of loons in Minnesota by conducting surveys, developing management plans, and supporting stewardship through public outreach as part of the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project. Like Minnesota loons in winter, Jaden migrated to Florida to pursue his bachelor's in biology and environmental studies at Eckerd College. Jaden, thanks for speaking to us today, and the floor is yours.
Great. Thank you so much. I'll go ahead and share my screen here. My name is Jaden Jeck. I'm a loon specialist and project lead with the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project at the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources. I just wanted to say thank you to Itasca Waters, Minnesota Sea Grant, and all other partners for making this presentation possible. I'm very grateful to be here today and excited to start sharing more about the conversation of loon restoration and protection here in Minnesota with the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project. The Minnesota Loon Restoration Project is part of the Non-Game Wildlife Program here at the DNR. And the DNR Non-Game Wildlife Program is supported through donations from community members across the state of Minnesota and beyond. So I just wanted to say thank you there for your support. And specifically, the Restoration of Common Loons in Minnesota project is funded by the Open Ocean Trustee Implementation Group through the Natural Resource Damage Assessment Deepwater Horizon Settlement. And I'll dive into a little bit more about our project history in just a minute. So here I am again on a rainy and cloudy day monitoring loons on the lakes of New Hampshire. I've since joined the Minnesota DNR in July of 2023, and I'm in the Ecological and Water Resources Division at the DNR. Like I said earlier, I migrated to Florida just like loons of Minnesota to pursue my bachelor's in biology and environmental studies, where I studied many bird species such as the brown pelican and threatened and endangered shorebirds on barrier islands on the coast. I migrated back north to work with loons in the state of New Hampshire with the Loon Preservation Committee before joining the DNR team here and working with loons in my home state. So I'm very happy to be here. Just to go over a little bit of an overview of what is going to be included in today's presentation. First, I'll start by giving a brief introduction of common loons here in Minnesota. I'll also talk about the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project and efforts that the DNR, along with partners and community members, are working on to support loon conservation and restoration across the state. I'll talk about opportunities for folks to continue loon stewardship and continue to be an active steward for loons and our freshwater resources here in the state of Minnesota. And then there will be plenty of time for any questions that you have, and I'll answer those as best as I can. So, to begin, the common loon, otherwise known with the scientific name as Gavia immer, has been Minnesota's state bird since 1961 and remains a symbol of Minnesota and Minnesota wilderness. We are very grateful to have a great population of loons in the state of Minnesota, and folks from across the state are working very hard to support their conservation as a symbol of Minnesota. These birds are specially adapted to be on the water diving, but they also spend a lot of time at sea. So I'll talk a little bit more about the common loon range, but these birds have the ability to dive over 200 feet deep, and can fly at amazing speeds. But they are not too good on land. Most of the time, loons will only go to land, right next to shore, for nesting purposes. Later on in the presentation, we'll talk about what to do if you do see a land or a loon on land, and provide you with some additional resources. Like I said, loons are specially adapted to be in the water, and they have solid bones that allow them to reach those depths and catch prey, in both Minnesota lakes and the ocean. In Minnesota, they have a beautiful seasonal plumage that is a black and white checkered with a bright red eye. But in the winter, loons do not have this plumage. They change color into a more gray to be more camouflaged on the ocean. So here I'll dive into a little bit more about what the common loon breeding range is. In the state of Minnesota, it includes northern and central Minnesota. On the graph here, on the left side, you can see typical common loon breeding range in the state of Minnesota, although loons can be seen across the state during periods of migration. On the right here, with a graph from the Cornell University Bird Lab, we see its overall range. Here in Minnesota, you can see the orange is the small portion of breeding populations of common loons in the United States, but primarily the breeding range of the loon occurs in Canada and Alaska. When they are migrating, they migrate to the Gulf of Mexico or southern Atlantic coast of the United States. And they typically will spend about 2 to 3 years before returning back to Minnesota lakes. So, just as much as we see them here in Minnesota, they really do spend quite a bit of time on the ocean, and can be considered seabirds. Common loon habitat in Minnesota varies, but loons prefer clear and very deep lakes. They prefer lakes with abundant forage fishes, such as cisco. Cisco are one of loons' favorite fishes, and they occur on lakes across the state of Minnesota. Loons prefer lakes with irregular shorelines, which includes islands and bays. This helps them find protected nesting locations that are crucial to supporting productivity of Minnesota loons. And it's a really unique thing that Minnesota lakes have that support loons. And so now I'm going to play a little some of the calls of the loons. I am hopefully inspiring people to look forward to the summer ahead of us. I'm going to begin by playing the tremolo call. The tremolo call can often be heard as a distress call, but you might also hear this call when they're flying overhead. And that's kind of a call of Minnesota, I think. The tremolo is recognized across the state and one of the most unique calls that loons have, and definitely a reminder of summer ahead. We also have the whale, and the whale is used during interactions among loons to regain contact with a mate or contact with other loons on the lake. I often think of this call as a call that occurs at night that you might hear across the lake, but they make this call during the day as well. Now, some people may refer to that call as haunting, but others say it's very beautiful and truly another unique call of loons. They're just so fascinating to listen to. The next we have is the yodel, which is another alarm or distress call produced only by male loons, and it's typically used in territorial defenses. Now, if you hear that call when you see a loon, you are probably too close. So, if you hear any of these distress calls while you're out on Minnesota lakes and you don't see other loons or predators of loons on the lake, be sure to keep your distance and give loons space. And then one of my favorites is the hoot. This is primarily used between pair members and loon chicks. So, I'll play that now. Alrighty, and those are the calls of the loons that scientists recognize, and we're able to find some of these meanings through observations and previous field research. And if you can, let us know what your favorite loon call is. Alrighty, so a little bit more about Minnesota's common loon population. So, monitoring data indicates that Minnesota's loon population is mostly stable. But recently, reporting from our Minnesota Loon Monitoring Program, the past 2 years in 2022 and 2023 has recognized slight declines in overall juvenile loon abundance in some index areas, so specific parts of Minnesota that are experiencing some declines in juvenile loon abundance. Minnesota's loon population is estimated to be about 12,000 adult common loons, which is the greatest in the continental United States behind Alaska. Alaska has the most common loons in the United States, but Minnesota is second. But as we saw earlier, common loons are present in other United States, such as New Hampshire, Maine, Vermont, Wisconsin, and more. In Minnesota, the common loon is recognized as a species of greatest conservation need. And that definition can be defined as a species that might be vulnerable to decline based on threats, or they also are great stewardship species to help protect other wildlife. And the loon checks both of these boxes. There is a number of threats that loons face both in the state of Minnesota and in their non-breeding range in the ocean, and we'll talk about those next. But they also have the opportunity to inspire stewardship for other species that are rare, vulnerable to decline, or declining. So they are overall just a great species to focus on conservation efforts for the state of Minnesota. Some potential threats to common loons are shoreline development. We begin to and continue to develop shoreline areas. Available nesting habitat becomes reduced for loons. And researchers across North America are working to understand the impact that shoreline development might have on loons. And shoreline development varies very often across the state. So continued research into these efforts is very important. We've also been seeing general impacts to water quality across the Common Loons Range here in Minnesota. Again, researchers across North America are working to understand the relationship between water quality and loon productivity. There's a number of factors that go into changes of water quality, which inc can include the use of pesticides and chemicals that might pose a threat to loons in Minnesota and in their non-breeding range. Lead fishing tackle is a known cause of mortality for loons in Minnesota and other parts of its breeding range, and other contaminants have been found to impact loons as well. We've partnered with other organizations to educate folks on the options of lead-free alternatives for fishing, and I'll talk more about our partnership there soon. Human disturbances. Humans have could potentially impact loon productivity by disturbing nest sites. Sometimes when a loon becomes scared from a disturbance from a human, they might flush the nest, accidentally knocking an egg into the water, or sometimes loons will not return to the nest after being flushed off the nest by a human disturbance. There's also potential for impacts from boat wake if approached too closely. Boat wakes have been recognized to swamp loon nests and unfortunately result in nest failure. The Minnesota DNR deploys loon nesting area signs at boat ramps across the state to help protect our state bird. We provide guidance on do not approaching loon to not approach loon nests, do not approach loon families, and the indication that loons are protected under both state and federal laws. And there's also impacts from potential disasters and disease outbreaks. Disasters such as oil spills are a potential threat to loons in Minnesota, which you might not necessarily think of, but that is where we started. We got our start with the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project. So let's dive in. The Minnesota Loon Restoration Project began after the 2010 Deepwater Horizons drilling unit that exploded in the Gulf of Mexico. After the explosion, there was a release of oil that caused extensive loss to wildlife and natural resources. Through continued settlements from the Deepwater Horizons oil spill and restoration plans to support species impacted by the oil spill, loons fell in the bird category. And the Minnesota DNR was awarded over $4 million to support the restoration of common loons through the non-game wildlife program. The goal of the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project is to reduce mortality and increase the reproductive success of common loons in the state of Minnesota. And in order to do so, we are working with a number of partners. We work with the U.S. Geological Survey for monitoring portions of our projects, and the United States Fish and Wildlife Service for guidance and coordination related to our cooperative agreement. Our funding is administered through the Department of Interior, which makes this program possible here in Minnesota. And we also are partnering with the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency, or MPCA, in partnering with their Get the Lead Out initiative to increase awareness and education regarding lead-free alternatives to lead fishing tackle. And in order to accomplish this goal with our partners, I have to say, we work with a number of community partners as well. And this work would not be possible without the support and engagement from community members across the state, including Itasca County. And we're doing so by the acquisition of lakeshore loon habitat, and we're also engaging the public in enhancing loon productivity with artificial loon nesting platforms. So the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project is focused in eight north central Minnesota counties, including Itasca County. This area was chosen because there's high potential to sustain quality loon habitat. If we think back to our habitat requirements for loons in Minnesota, these eight counties have great habitat available and opportunity to implement conservation actions to help sustain that habitat. And we're also confident that conservation efforts in this area will make a difference to support Minnesota loons. So these eight counties include Beltrami, Clearwater, Becker, Itasca, Hubbard, Cass, Crowing, and Aiken County. And we work across this eight county area, but also outside of this eight county area to help the restoration and conservation of Minnesota loons. And we do so through four primary objectives. The first is the acquisition of loon habitat. We augment natural nesting with artificial nesting platforms. We promote loon-friendly lake stewardship, and we monitor loons in project implementation. Our first objective is the acquisition of loon habitat, and this is our primary objective as part of the loon restoration project. And you might be asking, why is that your primary objective? Well, shoreline habitat and natural shoreline habitats are critical in supporting loon productivity and nesting in the state of Minnesota and beyond. Shoreline habitat is valuable for nesting, but also supports rearing and migration staging. Natural shoreline areas can promote great ecosystem benefits for the lakes of Minnesota and be very supportive of loons that are occupying Minnesota lakes for the entirety of their breeding season or during portions of migration. Our goal as part of our acquiring shoreline habitat is to turn these lands into managed lands, state lands for loons in Minnesota and for people of Minnesota, and to be managed for common loons. In locations or lakes that do not have opportunities to acquire natural shoreline areas or might have a lot of development, we are augmenting natural nesting locations with artificial nesting platforms. And we work with volunteers from across the state to implement and deploy, maintain, and recover these platforms throughout the summer. And this would not be possible without the folks across this eight county focal area dedicated to sponsoring these artificial nesting platforms. And artificial nesting platforms can be a great management tool and have been proven to increase productivity for loons in different parts of the country in their breeding range. So these platforms are used as management tools when there's a high water level fluctuation, which may be caused by extreme weather events or other changes to the landscape that cause water level fluctuations. If the shoreline is very developed and there's limited suitable habitat available, sometimes artificial nesting platforms can be a good solution to provide a nesting island for them. If there's examples of reoccurring predation, artificial nesting platforms can be used as a management tool. There's a number of predators that impact loons, or I should say, there are a number of predators that loons have, and this includes mammalian predators such as raccoons, or other mammals that occupy near shoreline areas. Putting the nesting platform a little ways out to water may limit or discourage the predation of mammalian predators by creating a barrier with the water, but sometimes this doesn't always work. Many of these predators are able to swim as well. And as you can see in this example here, this platform has an avian guard, which may prevent predation from eagles as being one of their predators as well. So loons have a number of natural predators. And lakes. But sometimes artificial nesting platforms aren't always the best management tool. So it's really important that you connect with the Minnesota DNR or other conservation organizations focused on supporting loon conservation to make sure that an artificial nesting platform will be a good management tool on your lake. We also are working hard to increase stewardship and education efforts with our Loon Friendly Lake Registry. So we have a number of lake associations across the state that are implementing voluntary actions to support loon conservation and lake conservation across their lakes in Minnesota. These lake associations are working very hard to implement strategies that are best suited for their lake and for the folks that visit and recreate on the lake. We often develop a loon-friendly lake management plan that in where we document the history of loons on the lake. We consider changes to the lake that have occurred over the recent years or extended periods of time to see what might be impacting loons on the lake. We look to barriers to loon productivity, and then we also recommend voluntary actions to improve lake and loon conditions on the lake. As well as we work hard to promote stewardship and education through public outreach, through presentations and community events. So here is myself and partners with the National Loon Center in Cross Lake and the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency Get the Lead Out folks. Partnering has been very critical and important for sharing stewardship information about loons, as we work with partners who are subject matter experts to educate and collaborate on implementing these strategies. So, like I said earlier, lead fishing tackle is a known cause of loon mortality, and the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency is working to reduce loon exposure to lead fishing tackle through education and outreach. If you're interested in learning more about Get the Lead Out and initiatives that they are leading, be sure to visit the Minnesota Pollution Control's website with Get the Lead Out. And then one of my favorite parts of my job and one of the unique things about our program is the opportunity to monitor loons on lakes across that 8-county focal area. So we are monitoring loons alongside many community scientists who are also monitoring loons through programs that I'll talk about later. But as part of our research, we're looking to or understand the occupancy of territories across lakes in Minnesota. We're looking at understanding nest searching and building, incubation of loon nests on loon nests. We're looking at potential nest failures and reason for nest failures across the state. We're looking at hatch dates and continuing to monitor rearing until loons are ready to fledge off the lake and make their annual migration down to the ocean. And we do so collaboratively with our partners at the U.S. Geological Survey. Another part we're looking at is understanding the effectiveness as artificial nesting platforms as management tools. And there are a number of ways that you too can also support loon conservation and restoration across the state of Minnesota. I'll go into each of these bullet points separately, but we have plenty of opportunities to participate in the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project. We encourage folks to be loon aware, which I'll talk a little bit about here. We have opportunities here at the Minnesota DNR to collaborate and participate in community science opportunities and to support ongoing loon and lake conservation efforts through local conservation organizations as well. So, participating in the Minnesota Loon Restoration Project, there's plenty of opportunities to get involved with loon restoration efforts here in the state. The first is if you live on a lake with a lake association, is to encourage your lake association to join the Loon Friendly Lake Registry and join a number of other lake associations across the state on implementing loon conservation strategies. If you live on a lake that doesn't have a lake association but are interested in becoming involved in creating a management plan for your lake, or looking for opportunities to implement conservation strategies, please give us a call or an email. My contact information will be at the end of this presentation, and we'll look for opportunities to collaborate and find ways to work together to implement some conservation initiatives. Also, we recommend if you're interested in deploying an artificial nesting platform that you speak with program staff to determine whether an artificial nesting platform may be suitable for your lake. Project staff are able to provide guidance on the best location for an artificial loon nesting platform, whether an artificial loon nesting platform would be a good tool for your lake, and provide some helpful insights onto the required permitting process that might be that might be occurring in your county. So loon nesting platforms do require typically a permit from the county sheriff's office. So if you're looking to deploy a platform, please do get in touch with DNR or your local county sheriff's office for more information regarding logistics. We also encourage you to join our partnership, just like we have in collaborating with the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency's Get the Lead Out initiative. This great team of folks working on the Get the Lead Out project are organizing a lead tackle collection opportunities and have lots of great information to share. The next that we encourage folks to do is to be loon aware. And recently, the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources has created a publication on being loon aware, which is an educational pamphlet that includes important information about recreating on Minnesota lakes and doing so loon safe. So I'm just going to highlight some of the information that's outlined in this publication. So the first that we do is we encourage boaters and recreators to be loon aware. If you see those loon nesting area signs at a public boat launch, be aware that loons might be nesting on those lakes. And from what we've learned in this presentation, they might be nesting in near shoreline areas that have lots of emergent vegetation. They might be found in quiet bays. And so, if you are recreating in those areas, be sure to keep your distance away from the shoreline area and give loons space. We also encourage folks who are boating to be aware of loons on the lake. Oftentimes, loons, chicks, do a behavior call. They are able to ride on the back of an adult loon. So loon chicks are able to climb on the back of adult loons, and oftentimes they might be hiding under a wing of an adult loon. And sometimes this can be difficult to identify when you are boating. So if you see a loon on the lake, be sure to slow down safely and make sure you keep loons safe by creating a big distance, whether you're on a kayak or a powerboat. Listen for loons. So we talked about loon calls earlier today, and you now know what those different calls mean. If you are viewing a loon and you hear one of those calls that might be a distress call, it's possible that there's another loon or predator in the area, but it's also possible that you might be too close to the loon and to give the loon space. So if you hear those distress calls, be sure to give the loon space and keep an appropriate distance. Watch what loons do. Loons exhibit a number of behaviors that will allow you to identify whether you're too close to a loon. One of those behaviors is called a penguin dance. The penguin dance is when a loon might appear to be standing up straight in the water and flapping its wings. It might also do an irregular diving pattern and display some of those distress calls. Those calls are typically a sign of a loon in distress, and to be sure to give a loon space if you see those calls. If you're a little too close to approaching a loon nest, you might see the loon lying very low on the nest bowl. And we typically call this posture the hangover posture, where loons will get very low to the loon nest and to the water to try to be invisible. If you see this behavior, the loon is all right, but you might be a little too close, and it's recommended that you give loons space. You might also see the brow of the loon raised a little. Kind of looks like someone is raising their eyebrows. This is often a sign that there might be some disturbance as well. So if you see any of these behaviors or have questions regarding any of these behaviors, it's best to give loon space and contact the DNR or other loon conservation organizations about what behavior you might be exhibiting. I talked a little bit about this. Responsible watercraft use is very important. Boat wake has the potential to swamp loon nests and cause nest failure. And there are also been cases of loons that have been struck by a powerboat at high speed. So be sure to keep a lookout for loons on the lake and be loon aware. And if you see anything that is alarming, please, please, please report harassment of loons to your local conservation officer or DNR office. Be sure to call the Minnesota DNR Information Center or local office non-game wildlife specialist or conservation officer to report instances of loon harassment. Like I said earlier, loons are protected by state and federal laws, and so harassment of loons and other wildlife is prohibited. If you're interested in joining on loon monitoring efforts, we are looking for volunteers to support several programs that we have at the Minnesota DNR Non-Game Wildlife Program. The first is the Volunteer Loon Watcher Survey. This survey is open to anyone who is able to visit a lake at least once per month from May through August. And we welcome participants from across the state in any county that has loons or may have the potential to support loons. If you're interested in joining and sharing your observations, your monthly observations from May through June, please visit our website at Volunteer Loon Watcher Survey as part of the Non-Game Wildlife Program. We have different resources there available for information about how to become involved and an email to get more information about the survey. This survey has been going on for over 40 years, and we have a long-term database that has great insights into loon phenology and loon behavior across Minnesota lakes. We also have the Minnesota Loon Monitoring Program. And this program is more of a census-type survey. Volunteers in designated index areas go out on lakes during a small time period in the middle of the summer and capture the number of loons that are occupying that lake. And the data from the Minnesota Loon Monitoring Program has and will continue to inform management decisions regarding Minnesota's loon population. So this is how we're able to track changes in Minnesota's loon population, and it wouldn't be possible without the hundreds of volunteers that are supporting both the Volunteer Loon Watcher Survey and the Minnesota Loon Monitoring Program. The Minnesota Loon Monitoring Program operates in specific index areas, and a map of on our website and available lakes can be found at the Non-Game Wildlife homepage as well. If you have any questions about becoming involved in community science opportunities, at the end of this presentation, I will provide an opportunity for you to send me an email, and I can direct you to the right place. We also encourage folks to continue to become involved. And by doing so here at this presentation, you are already joining ongoing loon and lake conservation initiatives. Here at the Minnesota DNR, we have great information about restoring shorelines to support loons and other wildlife with native plant buffers and more tools to help restore natural shore. Restore developed shorelines into more natural areas. And we also have great resources about maintaining natural shorelines, as maintaining natural shorelines is a lot easier than restoring developed shorelines. There's a lot of great opportunities at local government units, including soil and water conservation districts and land services, to learn more about permits that might be required for your shoreline area or opportunities to support some of your interest in protecting these near shoreline areas. Connecting with local conservation groups like we'd have at the Minnesota Pollu or at the Minnesota DNR has been very helpful, including partners with the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency. But local conservation groups have lots of opportunities to become involved with volunteer in opportunities and activities, as well as to have great resources for your area specifically. And then last, but certainly not least, is to continue to look and listen for loons on lakes, look for their enchanting call on Minnesota lakes, and be sure to share information about being loon aware and other important information about loon conservation with others at your lake association meeting, at work, at anywhere where there's opportunities to share information about loons. You're helping loons by sharing that information. So, yes. And I think wrapping things up a little bit early, but we'll have opportunities for questions. I'll leave this on my screen a little bit longer. Here is my email, mlrp.dnr@minnesotadnr.org. dnr at state.mn.us to ask any questions. You can also reach me by phone at 218-203-4326. And we have all of these resources available on our website at dnr.state.mn.us/eco/non-game. I'd like to say that photos are provided by the Minnesota DNR Non-Game Wildlife Program, unless otherwise stated. And again, we thank our federal sponsors for the funding from the Restoration of Common Loons in Minnesota by the Open Ocean Trustee Implementation Group through the Natural Resource Damage Assessment from the Deepwater Horizon Settlement. And we thank everyone for supporting the Non-Game Wildlife Program and supporting these long-term community science opportunities to better understand loons in Minnesota. So, with that, thank you all. I'll open the floor to questions and I'll stop sharing my screen.
Thank you, Jaden, not only for the great info, but also for putting us in a great summer mood. So let's go to the Q&A portion of today's program where you get your questions answered. Bill Granchus is our host. Bill is a longtime member of Itasca Waters and heads up Itasca County's Aquatic Invasive Species Program, and he's very active on the state level with other AIS programs. Bill?
Thank you, Brian. Jaden, outstanding presentation, by the way. Wow, I think I'm preaching to the choir here. We have so many questions already submitted, but hello, everybody. Welcome to Q&A section for today. You've been submitting your questions by using the Q&A icon. Fantastic. Don't use the chat function. We're not using that. Now, I'm going to read these questions out loud, and they're going to be answered by Jaden. Now, we're probably going to combine some similar questions. And we might not get to every question. If you still have a question after the program, you can send us, you can either email Jaden directly, as he just said, or send a question to info@itascawaters.org after the program. Okay, Jaden, let's get our first question. This comes from Ken. My lake has the ability to lower the water level when it becomes too high. At time, the lake levels have dropped below recommended levels during nesting. Does this affect new nesting? Will they abandon the nest? Thank you.
Yeah, so thank you for the question there. Great question. And as I stated earlier in the presentation, water level fluctuations do have the ability to cause a nest or the potential to cause a nest failure. Oftentimes, we see changes in water level fluctuation that includes increases of water level due to extreme rain events. But there could possibly be potential to disrupting loon nesting with low water levels. The water level management is a little outside of my wheelhouse, so I would recommend contacting a DNR area hydrologist for more information regarding management of water level or the local government unit assisting with the management of the water level on the lake. So, water level can influence loons, but it's the management of the water level is a little bit outside of my wheelhouse.
Thank you for that. Okay, next question. What has the increase in swans on lake had on loon population in northern Minnesota?
Yeah, so as far as I know, we have not had the opportunity to research that relationship between swans and loons. So right now, that we don't know if there's a relationship between swans and loons, but the swan population in Minnesota has been increasing thanks to efforts related to the Non-Game Wildlife Program and the swan restoration project. So here at the Non-Game Wildlife Program, we are looking at supporting all non-game wildlife species and supporting their conservation to the best of our ability.
Excellent. Okay, some of this has been covered, but Ed asks, are the yodels used only in defending territory from other loons, or are they used in defending against other birds or animals or even fish?
Yeah, so the yodel is a call produced only by male loons, so only male loons will yodel. But yes, you are correct. You might also hear a yodel in instances where there might be a predator, sometimes overhead, such as a bald eagle. You might hear a yodel call, but also how male loons can yodel due to other disturbances, including disturbances from humans and other predators, as stated. So yes, this call is a distress call, and it can be used. It's used in territorial interactions, but it's also used in other instances as well.
Interesting. I have a friend of mine submitted a question that asked, well, more commented that her Pomeranian loves to go for boat rides on their pontoon, but the loons actually swim towards the Pomeranian when it starts yapping. Sorry, when it starts yapping at the loons. I mean, might the loons be interested in a small dog like that, or?
That's a really good question, and I continue to be amazed by the unique stories and instances that people have across the state having interactions with loons in several different instances. And I think that's one of the unique things about this interesting bird is that there's so many opportunities that Minnesotans and people who visit Minnesota have had to share their interesting observations. So I am not exactly sure whether the loon is interested. Particularly in a dog, but there are a number of instances that have been reported that are unique to loons. Sometimes we hear about loons swimming underneath kayaks and folks being able to see loons as they swim underneath bridges. Here in Minnesota, on the land of 10,000 lakes, we have lots of unique opportunities to interact and have interesting interactions with this incredible species.
Thank you for that. Okay, Wesley asks, how is the loon population impacted by climate change in Minnesota?
Yeah, so right now the Minnesota DNR is continuing to monitor the loon population here through community science efforts. And we have been doing so and studying specific index areas across the state. And so far, we've seen a stable population, somewhat stable population for the most part across the state here. But there are a number of biologists that predict loons to be influenced by climate change in the future because of changes in temperature, water quality, all of the threats that we discussed, climate change has, or for some of the threats that we discussed earlier, climate change has the potential to either increase the risk of those threats, or there might be new threats that are on the horizon. So, definitely something that we're looking at continuing to monitor and track.
Fantastic. Thank you. Jean asks, are loons territorial? Would multiple loon families be found on the same lake?
Yes. So, and yes, and yes. Loons are extremely territorial birds, and they will occupy a territory, and they will do all they can to defend that territory. So, depending on the size of the lake, there might only be one loon pair that occupies that entire lake. For small lakes, typically one pair will occupy that lake. In instances where there are very large lakes in Minnesota, there are opportunities to support several loon pairs as long as they have that territory boundary established. So, as we talked a little bit about earlier, some of the calls that loons might be displaying or some of the behaviors that loons might be displaying when interacting with one another may actually be territorial interactions, and they're looking to continue to maintain that territory.
Thank you. Next question. How much correlation is there between water quality and loon mortality?
That's a great question, and I don't have specifics about that. There is a number of researchers working on questions related to water quality and how that impacts loon populations across the United States. So if you're looking for more information, please send either Itasca Waters an email or myself an email, and we'll try to direct you to researchers working on that question.
Fantastic. Tom wants to know, do you have on YouTube, for example, any live feeds on loon nests?
Currently, the Minnesota DNR does not have any live feeds on Loonness. The Minnesota DNR does host the Eagle Cam, so we have a view of eagles, but we don't have one on loons. But there's a number of conservation organizations that may have that available. So if you're interested, and I'll look and I can try to find some, but feel free to send us an email.
Okay. Karen asks, has a suitable replacement for lead tackle been developed or is it near development?
Yeah, there are a number of lead-free alternatives that are used for fishing. And so I would direct folks interested in learning more about those alternatives and locations to find alternatives to visit the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency's Get the Lead Out program. They have a great resource on their website to direct you to those alternatives with more information about each.
Talking of lead, Tom asks, how do we get the lead out of lakes?
Yeah, there's a number of different ways. The first is encouraging your lake association to partner with the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency, as they are experts in reducing lead and getting the lead out of Minnesota lakes. There are opportunities to fish lead-free, and there's more information on MPCA's website regarding that. And then just having the conversation with folks across the lake about the impact that lead fishing tackle can have on loons, and continuing the conversation. So, again, the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency has a lot of great resources there.
Oops. Thank you. Well, we talked about territory and we talked about artificial nests, but here's one that combines both of them. Is there an artificial breeding program for loons? Oops, sorry, wrong. I'll get to it. Is there an artificial breeding program for loons? Like is none for fish, or captured and then relocated to other lakes?
So I'm thinking, like, the question might be regarding relocation or movement of loons to different lakes. In Minnesota, we do not do that. There's no effort for that in the state of Minnesota.
Thank you. Okay, now here's the question I meant to read. Someone writes, I am on a 400-acre sized lake with two natural loons nests. Could an additional artificial nest be counterproductive or have other drawbacks? Is a good motto, quote, do no harm, unquote.
So there's continuous research to better understand how artificial nesting platforms can be supportive for loons, but also just understanding more about the impact of artificial nesting platforms on loons. And in some cases, and it's very, very lake specific. So I would recommend contacting myself or another loon conservation organization for more guidance, because the shape of the lake can also impact the territory size of the
Sure.
loon and the area they're occupying. If I, this is a potential, but if there are loon territories that are very close to each other, there might be an increased disturbance from in territorial interactions. And that might influence nesting. But I know there's additional researchers, there's more researchers working on this topic. So if you have more specific questions, I can direct you to those resources as well.
Okay, I think we have time for another question. Oh, I like this one. Rose wants to know, is there a process for reporting injured loons?
Yes, there are. If you come across an injured loon, please do give us a call at the DNR. You can call the DNR Information Center, my phone number, or your local DNR office, and we will do our best to find some help to assist with that process. Otherwise, there are a number of licensed wildlife rehabilitators across the state of Minnesota that will help injured loons. So I would recommend giving them a call. And if you have questions about the nearest wildlife rehabilitation center near you, the Minnesota DNR has a list of licensed wildlife rehabilitators on our website. So if you're thinking about this upcoming season, it might be good to check in to see one, where your nearest Minnesota DNR office is and the phone number for that. Two, maybe your local conservation officer, and three, your licensed wildlife rehabilitator that's nearest you. And we'll do our best we can to help.
Thank you, Jaden. I think that's all the time we have for questions. Thank you for everyone that submitted questions. There are quite a few that we didn't get to. Again, remember you can email us if you'd like us to get those answered and get back to you on that. Okay, Brian, turning it back over to you.
All right, thank you very much. And to both Jaden and Bill, if you have questions that we didn't get to today before time ran out, you can send them to info@itascawaters.org and they'll be forwarded. Our next Water Wisdom program will be on May the 2nd, and the topic will be how the state determines fish management strategies, including stocking. To register, go to our website, itascawaters.org. If you'd like to watch today's program or again, or recommend it to your family, friends, or neighbors, a recording of today's talk will soon be on our website at itascawaters.org, along with all of our previous programs. We'd like to get your feedback, so please click on the survey link, which will be on screen at the end of today's program. You can see it right now at the bottom right. Or if you prefer, respond to the evaluation form that we will be emailing you. I'm Brian Whittemore, and thank you all for being with us today.